empowerment of women will not be complete without empowering those who are living at India's last pyramid, the ones whose day starts before sunrise and continues after sunset. These are the women farmers of India whose voices go unheard even to their own gender. This is a very beautifully written quote by Oxfam India, which is a non-profit organization working towards empowering women farmers in India. So let's talk about this. 73.2% of rural women work in agriculture, yet the face of farming is meat. Why is it that the foundational backbone of agriculture is shrouded in darkness? This statistic is according to the Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation. This happens because women are not given equal access to productive resources, and they are not given direct instruction about advanced agricultural practices and technologies. So even if the number of rural women working is so high, they do not have the same kind of facilities as the men do. That brings us to an important question about empowering women. As it stands, this cannot be feasible if women are not given autonomy, if they do not have an identity. They need to have influence over their own social, economic, and health-related aspects. They need to be represented in politics. They need to have themselves visible and represented in the policies that are created. So, what exactly is holding them back? The short answer would be the usual: patriarchy, gender disparity, gender-based discrimination, gender inequalities, etc. But let's explore this further. According to Oxfam, the non-profit organization I talked about before, 80% of the farm work is undertaken by women, but only 12.8% of them have landholdings. Despite multiple legal provisions to ensure otherwise, a majority of land is inherited by men. How much exactly? Well, I know you can see it on the screen, but 83% of the total land is inherited by men. There have been many legal provisions, such as the Hindu Succession Act, which was amended back in 2005. What they wanted to do was to provide equal inheritance rights to males and females, especially with the focus on females, so that sons and daughters are not discriminated against. But this, something like this, is not very recent. The government has not only been working towards this for the last decade and a half. This is much older. For example, the 9th five-year plan, it was from 1997 to 2002, in which the government wanted to ensure that land should be taken from traditional landowners and it should be redistributed to those who are actually working on that land, out of which 40% were women. And the rest were not just men, but also it was a joint ownership between males and females. It was a joint ownership between husband and wife. Then furthermore came the 10th five-year plan. It was to provide concessions to female property or female property buyers upon registration. And then this would incentivize women to buy property in their own name. But as you see, as it stands, only 12.8% of women have land holdings. So these progressive legal provisions are not exactly useful. Now you might be wondering, why is land holding so important? They are still working as farmers, right? Not exactly, and that's the catch. Our census only recognizes landless women farmers as cultivators and not farmers. Again, why does this label matter? Well, let's open the Pandora's box. Women who are not recognized as farmers, who do not own land, cannot access their rights, cannot avail schemes, cannot be introduced, cannot be included in the policies, and so much. But just listing this is not very insightful, so I'll dig deeper into that. Access to credit requires possessions, but in rural India, a majority of the possessions are in the husband's name. So for a scheme like Kisan Credit Card Program, women have to drag their husbands along, and even then they might get denied access to this very crucial facility. The diplomat points out that even the farming sector nor the macroeconomic policy framework recognizes women as farmers. What this means is that they cannot seek institutional support from banks, insurances, and government departments, etc. This in turn hinders the their socio-economic mobility, and also just their day-to-day lives. Another important variable is to consider is male migration. When males migrate, it redefines the roles of women. It, in turn, it gives them increased responsibilities and labor to amount for, not just in the farms, but even in their own households. Farmer suicides. When male farmers commit suicide, they leave behind a lot of debt and burden, which women have to carry. But it is important to note that suicides committed by female farmers, by women farmers, are not even recognized. They are an invisible wound. An NDTV report pointed out the flaw in the system. It pointed out the gross neglect. As women do not have land, these women are landless. They are not recognized as farmers, and their families are not compensated for the suicides. Government identifies 15th of October as Women Farmers Day. This could be a pivotal step according to some. They say it will acknowledge and reward women for their hard work that they've been doing. But some others say that this might only be a form of tokenism, and it's not very viable unless there is a good, sustainable institutional and legislative change that's backing this up. So, to remedy this, what can be done? There is one way to fast track getting women to their rights. Owning land is essential, it's very important. Not just that, it's the fundamental right for women to have land. It's pivotal in getting them the agency, but also it's a gargantuan task. It's very difficult, and the sole focus on owning land has been depriving women of their own rights for far, far too long. So agricultural scientist Swaminathan proposed the concept of identity cards for women. What this would do is get them to avail the schemes, be included in the policies, get faster access to credit and more such. But then nothing comes without its criticisms. So a criticism for this is government already has the national registry. Why does this even matter? Issuing cards might not really be feasible. It's not that women have entirely been absent from the government's eyes. Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare once stated in a Lok Sabha that 30% of budgetary allocations has been given on various schemes to women. But it's important to notice that since 2014, the fund utilization for these sorts of schemes has drastically gone down, while the budget for Ministry of Agriculture has actually increased. Even income guarantee schemes like Pradhan Mantri Samman Nidhi Yojana, which promises Rs. 6,000 to farmers who have under 2 hectares of land, is pretty much useless to the aforementioned females. Why? You guessed it. Because they do not own land, they are not considered farmers. Luckily, non-profits and other organizations like Oxfam and Self-Employed Women's Organization India, which is Seva Bharat, and also it is one of the largest informal workers organizations in the world, has been working towards providing women security, support and agency. Still, there are leagues to go and miles to cover till these female farmers receive the rights that they so deserve. United Nations estimates an increase of 20 to 30% in yields if women are provided the same access to productive resources as men. This could be the answer to decrease poverty and hunger in India. India is in a dire need to introduce schemes and policies that are specifically designed for women and especially for landless women. Complications and setbacks for these women are not entirely legislative. As we already know, and a lot of speakers have already discussed this, that these are also very intensely social. Women do not have to only overcome the lack of legal provisions, but also they have to struggle with their social roles. Some of them have to wear cumbersome clothing out in the field. Some wear saris with pallus covering their faces. These women work in the scorching Indian sun and then head back home to do their domestic and social duties. The motherland blooms under the nourishing hands of India's Annapurnas. The soil witnesses their battles. The only way to achieve sustainable development is to empower the women who run this nation. Thank you.